Once again, we are entering an all-new year here at WNUT, so thus, welcome to the all-new WNUT 98. Not much has happened since we last left you with our WNUT 97 Christmas special. Not a lot's been happening in the lives of either me or Eric, but, you know, we've just been plugging along and we've got a full program of crap here, including the twist contest, which no one has yet won. And we got some good stuff for you, like a report on the Hall of Fame assembly. What a hit that one was. We have seen the end of Mullis Mixes with the release of my last Mullis Mixes album, and we'll have some from that. Plus, we're gonna talk about the WNUT World Tour, which is really good. But for right now, we have a message from the Godfather of Soul, James Brown, straight from Augusta, Georgia. Here he is.
Blues Brother 2000. See it.
If anyone heard WJAZ Part 3, you're familiar with that message. So for right now, let's see what we got lined up for you. I received this informative piece via email lately from Chris Smith, and he sent me this message basically about how wonderful the F word really is. I mean, you never really think about how many different ways you can use it, but then you get this report, and it all clicks for you. So I'm going to read this to you. It's a report called The F Word. Perhaps one of the most interesting and colorful words in the English language today is the word fuck. It is the one magical word which, just by its sound, can describe pain, pleasure, love, and hate. In language, fuck falls into many grammatical categories. It can be used as a verb, both transitive, John fucked Mary, and intransitive, Mary was fucked by John. It can be an action verb, John really gives a fuck. A passive verb, Mary doesn't really give a fuck. An adverb, Mary is fucking interested in John. Or as a noun, Mary is a terrific fuck. It can also be used as an adjective, Mary is fucking beautiful. Or as an interjection, fuck, I'm late for my date with Mary. It can even be used as a conjunction, Mary is easy, fuck, she's also stupid. As you can see, there are very few words with the overall versatility of the word fuck. Aside from its sexual connotations, this incredible word can be used to describe many situations. For instance, greetings, how the fuck are ya? Fraud, I got fucked by the car dealer. Resignation, oh fuck it. Trouble, I guess I'm fucked now. Aggression, fuck you! Disgust, fuck me. Confusion, what the fuck? Difficulty, I don't understand this fucking business. Despair, fucked again. Pleasure, I fucking couldn't be happier. Displeasure, what the fuck is going on here? Lost, where the fuck are we? Disbelief, unfucking believable. Retaliation, up your fucking ass. Denial, I didn't fucking do it. Perplexity, I don't know fuck about this. Apathy, who really gives a fuck? Suspicion, who the fuck are you? Panic, let's get the fuck out of here. Directions, fuck off. Disbelief, how the fuck did you do that? Page 2. It can be used in an anatomical description. He's a fucking asshole. It can be used to tell time. It's 5:30. It can be used in business. How did I wind up with this fucking job? It can be maternal. Motherfucker. It can be political. Fuck Dan Quayle. It has also been used by many notable people throughout history. For instance, what the fuck was that? Said by the mayor of Hiroshima. Or, where the fuck is all this water coming from? Said by the captain of the Titanic. Or, that's not a real fucking gun. Said by John Lennon. Or, who's gonna fucking find out? Said by Richard Nixon. Or there's also, any fucking idiot could understand that, said by Albert Einstein. Or, it does so fucking look like her, said by Picasso. Or, how the fuck did you work that out, said by Pythagoras. Or, my personal favorite, you want what on the fucking ceiling, said by Michelangelo. Why? Because it's fucking there, Edmund Hillary. I don't suppose it's gonna fucking rain, said by Joan of Arc. Or, Noah, with these immortal words, scattered fucking showers my ass. And then the very final one on our list, I need this parade like I need a fucking hole in my head, said by the legendary John F. Kennedy. So apparently, fuck can be used in many, many grammatical situations. For instance, if you're sitting in a restaurant, and nobody's been serving you, but you've been waiting and waiting and waiting on your service, all you gotta do, I guarantee, if you stand up and just yell, fuck, it won't be 5 seconds, somebody will be at your table to help you. I guarantee you. Try it. So begin using fuck more and more in your everyday life, and just see the reaction that it gets. Thank you. So what'd you think about that informative piece, Eric?
That was pretty good. I wonder why Chris never sent me that. He must want to lose at the chain letters contest. Yeah. I would have counted that.
Because, You know, Chris, it's like, if you got something good, you need to share it with everybody.
Yeah, man.
Tell us what's been going on in your life, Eric.
I don't know. Everything's been going pretty good. We started the WNUT webpage. Everybody needs to come see this.
Everybody got to go to that. It's members.aol.com/, capgs/index.html.
Or you can just keep off the index.html and it'll bring you right to it. But we'll print it up in the newsletter so you can see something. It'll be a lot easier.
WNUT has been going on a world tour. This legendary, no matter what broadcast it is, WNUT has been making rounds in the last year. It's been going everywhere. I mean, like, people were just taking on vacation, and WNUT's really been traveling. I mean, I've taken it to the Bahamas. It's gone twice, actually, because Mike took it. It's been to Washington, D.C. It's been to New York. I took it to Daytona Beach. Eric and Matt took it to France. Let's see. It's just been all around the world. Can you think of anywhere else where it might have been?
Nope, can't think of anywhere else.
Well, let's see. On the WNUT World Tour, we've been making stops so far. Bahamas, Washington, D.C., New York, Daytona Beach, France. Where else might WNUT go? For instance, Mexico? England? Maybe even hell. You just never know with WNUT. We'll never run out of places we could possibly go. And trust me, we're gonna go a lot more. We're making our rounds. For instance, we might possibly even go to San Francisco. You just never know. So, no matter where you are on this lovely globe of ours, make sure you look for WNUT, because we could honestly pop up anywhere, and that's no lie. Thank you. So, Eric, how's your day been? Has it been all right?
It's been all right, but then my teacher told me I had to come back to school tomorrow on my day off to finish some computer shit.
Oh yeah, by the way, this is being made on a Thursday, and we get Friday off school, but Eric has to go back to school to work on a project Friday?
Yeah, something like that.
And are you upset at Miss Davis?
That pisses me off.
So apparently Eric's had a bad day. And what better way to commemorate this than play Eric's Had a Bad Day by SNFU. So here goes. Eric's had a bad day.
We'll be right back.
and that was Eric's Had a Bad Day by a glorious little punk band there called SNFU, and how appropriate, because Eric's had a pretty bad day. Actually, I think his bad day is going to start tomorrow. So, as we are recording this on March the 26th, which is a Thursday, right before April starts here, and we got the Masters going on from the 9th through the 12th of April, something like that, we are doing our Masters 1998 edition, our salute to other people's balls. Right. Titliest and all those other kind of balls. So I wish good luck to all the people at the Masters this year, and hopefully Tiger Woods won't slaughter the crap out of you quite as bad as he did last year. But...
fuck all those white people. Tiger Woods.
Yeah. Okay. Well, speaking of the sex organs and all such as that, Mr. Rushton has this habit about telling us all about his sex life. He'll be explaining something. What was he explaining that day in class? Like, England and Ireland's feud with each other.
Yeah, and he was talking about the Anglo-Saxons.
He was talking about something so far off from the subject. Like,
And all of a sudden he told us how he tried to score with his wife before he was married, but she's very strong-headed and,
Okay, he got so far. This was back in January. It says here January the 7th, because I keep this little notepad with me to write down all these glorious little ideas. He just gets so far off the subject, talking about, you know, I wished my wife could have laid me before. He didn't phrase it like this, but he's talking about, oh, she never did.
Actually, he was pretty happy. He was like, I'm glad she never did.
Yeah, he seemed to be like, oh, and he, by the way, he was like, now don't think I didn't ever ask her about it. And I'm sitting there thinking, okay, we're in English 4, and he's explaining, he's setting us up to read some Chaucer thing or something, and I'm like, really, why do we need to know this? I mean, what did it have to do with the thing? And Mr. Rushton has this habit of somehow making his way back to the topic eventually, but it didn't happen this day. He just went on until the bell rang, talking about getting laid, or lack thereof, and it was really fun.
You know what? I think it was better than English. Mr. Rushton, you can talk about that anytime you want.
Yeah, it's pretty cool. I just kind of wonder, like, you know, what makes this guy do this? I can't imagine, like, Miss Belger just starting all of a sudden, you know, back before I got married, I really wanted to screw my husband, but I never really did. Instead, I was a coot. So, let's see. On to something else. Our twist contest. Has anyone figured this out yet? Twist. Can you understand it, Eric?
You're not supposed to understand it.
I happen to have received a fax earlier. I got three of them, as a matter of fact. And these are the official entries in our twist contest. The first one I got says, twist. Okay, here are the lyrics they put down. It says, gibberish. Twist, 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 twist. Gibberish. Twist, twist, twist. This is complete and utter bullshit. We want to know what the man is saying, and it's a little bit longer than gibberish. Then I got this next one. These are the lyrics on fax number two. Entry number two in the twist contest. UNUT URAT DOT INDOP URAT DOT INDOT. And it, okay, it's basically that the whole time. There's a few think about pi eras thrown in there. Then it says twist, 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 twist. Then they throw in some more of the same old garbage. And I'm sorry to say, this.
Well, that's very close.
You would have been our winner. You really would have. Because you spent.
Somebody went to distance.
You spent some time on this. But then we got fax number three. And let me tell you what this one says. By the way, folks, this is in no way at all what he's saying, but it's just so original.
So creative.
It's the most creative thing I've ever seen in my life. This is Chris McNeil's entry. It says, twist. You're not rat dat not. Then they push, stop it, take a minute, rat. Take a mob at that. Then I pick up a rock. So then I pretend to pick up a bat. Rock, something in my heart. It don't matter. I remember rocks, something. Running in my, I hit the bone. I think, why is it so? Rock said, I do not exaggerate. Over it now. Getting up, but I run. Nothing but a rock. Twist, twist, twist. Although they forgot verse 2, this was the most original entry that we got. Facts number 3. Chris McNeil.
I really don't think it sounds anything like that.
I really don't either. It's complete and utter BS, but it really is our most original entry. And Chris is an enforcer, and he went the distance for this. I don't know if he thought this up or sat down and wrote this out or found it on a webpage, but Chris, you're our winner. Come by our studio to claim your prize, or we'll get it to you somehow. So, with that in mind, someone having won this contest, we've got an all-new one for you. Actually, if you were a fan of ours back in 1994, this is in no way a new contest, but it was abandoned, and no one ever learned the lyrics to the song and actually got them to us. So, we're going to revive this old 1994 WNUT challenge. This is the song that for... How long has this song been out? For absolutely 5 years now, has completely baffled all of us here at WNUT, and we've put it on, I think, like all eight of our broadcasts from 1994, not a single response. It's more unclear than Twist. So, if you can understand the lyrics to this song, please get in touch with us. Here is your brand new WNUT challenge.
Informer, you know, say that I'm a stormy, I go blam. I'll keep bum bum bam. Take the man that says that I'm a stormy, slam somewhere down the lane. I'll keep bum bum bam. Informer, you know, say that I'm a stormy, I go blam. I'll keep bum bum bam. Take the man that says that I'm a stormy, slam somewhere down the lane. I'll keep bum bum bam. These are the men who come in and they blow down my door. Rain you can pour through my window, so they put me in the back of the car at the station. From that point on, I reached my destination, where the destination region had a east detention. With a look down my pants, look up my bottom. So informer, you know, say that I'm a snowman, I go glam. I'll keep boom boom damn. Take the man that says that I'm a snowman, stop somewhere down the lane. I'll keep boom boom damn. Informer, you know, say that I'm a snowman, I go glam. I'll keep boom boom damn. Take the man that says that I'm a snowman, stop somewhere down the lane. They think them have more power. They point the phone, me say they wanna war. Me for want to use the one to now me call me lover. Love who me calling and the one tell me. And me lover in my heart down to my belly. Yes, and I'm a stomach, I feel cool and deadly. It's the one MC Shine and the one that is low. Together we all have a Mr. Tornado. Informer, you know, say that I'm a stomach, I go glam. I'll keep boom boom damn. Take the man that says that I'm a stomach, stop somewhere down the lane. I'll keep boom boom damn. Informer, say that I'm a stormy, I go glam. I'll keep boom boom damn. Take the man that says that I'm a stormy, stop somewhere down the lane. I'll keep boom boom damn. So listen for me, you better listen for me now. Listen for me, you better listen for me now. Bring me the rubber, the rifle, the foam, the rock and steady. You say that I'm a stormy, I the art to cut down. But I'm not in and I have the dance. I mean, say where you come from. People them say you come from Jamaica, but me born and raised in the ghetto, don't know what you know. Pure brown people, man, is all I'm on. My shoes and them tear up and my toes just a show. When me a ball and other one Toronto. So informer, you know, say that I'm a stormy, I go glam. I'll keep boom boom damn. Take the man that says that I'm a stormy, stop somewhere down the lane. I'll keep boom boom damn. Informer, you know, say that I'm a stormy, I go glam. I'll keep boom boom damn. Take the man that says that I'm a stormy, stop somewhere down the lane. I'll keep boom boom damn. Come with a nice young lady, intelligent, yes, she jungle in Ari. Everywhere me go, me never left for a tally. You say that it's no me, I the rum dance man. Rum it in a dance, I in a nation. You never know, say that I'm a stormy, I the boom shaka. Tell me never lay you down flat in a one cardboard box. You say that I'm a stormy, I go region at the top. So informer, you know, say that I'm a stormy, I go glam. I keep boom boom damn. Take the man that say, say that I'm a stormy, stop stumble down the lane. I keep boom boom damn. Informer, you know, say that I'm a stormy, I go glam. I keep boom boom damn. Take the man that say, say that I'm a stormy, stop stumble down the lane. I keep boom boom damn. Why would?
I'm sitting around cooling with my dibby dibby girl. Police knock my door, lick up my pal. Rough me up and I can't do a thing. Pick up my line when my telephone ring. Take me to the station, black up my hands. Trail me down cause I'm hanging with the snowman. What I'm gonna do, I'm backed in a trap. Slap me in the face and took all of my gap. They have no clues and they wanna get warmer. But Sham won't turn informer.
Informer, you know, say that I'm a stormy, I go glam. I'll keep boom boom damn. Take the man that says that I'm a stormy, stop somewhere down the lane. I'll keep boom boom damn. Informer, you know, say that I'm a stormy, I go glam. I'll keep boom boom damn. Take the man that says that I'm a stormy, stop somewhere down the lane. I'll keep boom boom damn. Diddly dong, diddly diddly dong, damn boy, ing boy, ing boy, ing boy.
You will get a WNUT coffee mug if you can tell us what the lyrics to that are. Now, NUT News.
In other unimportant news, everybody's least favorite singer, Michael Bolton, cut his hair. A girl in French class said, "Did you see the Oscars? Michael Bolton cut his hair and he looks a lot better." And I said, "No, I did not see that."
So now, he's not a long-haired puss, he's a short-haired puss.
Yeah, but in other news, Michael Bolton, you heard it right, cut his hair. He now has very short hair.
And also, in other news, editor number one cut his hair, and he hates it. I don't like it very much.
NUT News.
Straight from Augusta, Georgia, here's the godfather of soul, James Brown.
Blues Brothers 2000. See it.
Absolutely right. Blues Brothers 2000. See it. See that shit. For your motherfucking self. Thank you. You know, while on the subject of Mr. Rushton, he's in the midst of showing us this 6-hour-long movie, or 5 hours and 57 minutes, called Middlemarch. Give us some commentary on this, Eric. Isn't this just the greatest movie you've ever seen in your life?
Well, no. Actually, it's probably the longest movie I can say I've ever watched. If you thought Titanic was bad, imagine sitting in a movie theater after drinking a big Slurpee and have to sit for almost 6 hours holding your bladder back. Fortunately, we're watching over a 12-day period at school. Most of you might say, "Well, good, you don't have to do English." Well, you also can't sleep in his class, or he'll pick you up and body slam you.
Yeah.
And, that's bad.
So instead, I do this stuff, like writing the WNUT notepad and write stuff for our newsletter, but the movie just continues to drag on and on unnecessarily.
About all it does is give you a bad neck crick and make you very bored.
And there's a girl in there named Dodo.
Yeah, there's a girl in the movie Middlemarch named Dildo.
Yeah, he's got written up on the board, Dodo, like next to this girl's name, because her name's Dorothea, and I guess like her life mate or whatever, her little girlfriend calls her Dodo. So he's got written up on the board Dodo, and I looked up there and it looked like it said dildo, and then I thought, well, you know, that's written in chalk, so if I find a piece of chalk and he's out of the room for a second. So anybody that has Mr. Rushton, trust me, that movie's probably going to go on for about 2 more weeks. So watch that part on the board where it says Dodo. You might just see it change before your very eyes. Just out of nowhere. Now, Middlemarch, let me explain this movie. If you've ever seen The Great Gatsby, or Pride and Prejudice, or The Importance of Being Earnest, it's like the same movie.
Or any other novel written in the, you know, 40s or 50s.
All they do is, okay, they write about the 19th century, and it's like the same thing. It's like, these people like those people, but those people like some other people. So these people decide they don't like those people anymore, they like the other people, but the other people don't like these people, they like those people. So we don't have anybody that likes each other until one of them just wakes up one morning and decides, wait, I like that person that liked me before, but now they don't like him back. So what they do is they go out and somebody dies, or somebody gets hurt, or somebody turns out to be somebody that they thought they weren't, and then these people don't like these people anymore, but somebody from this group and that group end up together, but everybody else just hates each other. That's basically it for every single movie like that.
You know what, come think of it, I think Pride and Prejudice was made in the 90s, but yeah, that's just a technicality.
Pride and Prejudice, no
sir. Not written in the 90s, not that, set in the 90s, but you know, made in the movie.
Oh, that version that you saw?
Yeah.
Yeah. Eric took the shortcut and got the 6-hour A&E version, and
no,
really,
it was more like 4 hours. Oh, okay.
I really wish I had done that myself. Instead, I got the Cliff's Notes and screwed myself over. So, I did real good on that test, needless to say. And
me neither.
I was noticing the other day, like, what's that movie called? Firestorm or something? It's like every movie that they've brought out in the past decade has had more human than human in the advertisement. Have you noticed this?
Yep.
It stops nowhere. I mean, let's see, what are all the movies that had that in there? There was that Firestorm, and then I can't remember it. But there were a pile of them, because every time I'm sitting in the movie theater, there's some kind of advertisement that has that on there. I mean, it never ends. It's like Soul Food, starring Vanessa Williams. You won't regret coming to see this movie. Come see it now. They all have that in there, but they never get to this part. They never get to this. But it's like Pride and Prejudice, A story about the hardships of the 1800s. It'll make you go to sleep.
If you suffer from insomnia, just watch our movie.
Or read this book.
9 out of 10 doctors recommend this movie. For trouble at going to sleep at night.
It ends nowhere.
Oh, hey, it's Brandon. What's up, guys? You're hearing me a few years after this episode was recorded. There should actually be an intro that you're hearing right now to a Marilyn Manson song, and then that Marilyn Manson song, but you're not hearing any of that right now. Not because the song is blocked, like the Eagles song in episode 6 or the AC/DC tracks in episode 11. No, the reason you're not hearing Younger Me and the Marilyn Manson song right now is because the title of the song is Rock and Roll N-Word. And when I say that, I mean the actual N-word is in the title. And I'm not saying the title of the song for that reason. It's the main reason this episode hasn't been available to stream yet. But since I've already had to do this a few times for blocked songs, I figured why not do the same thing to talk about the Manson song and its context. Now, it's easy to look back with what we know about Marilyn Manson today and think, well, you should have known that was a bad move because Manson is a very problematic figure for a lot of reasons now. But remember, this episode was recorded in 1998. He wasn't yet. He was just a massive rock star, giving a voice to a demographic of kids who had felt bullied and picked on and pushed around. The song wasn't even written by him in the first place. It was a cover of a song by Patti Smith from 1978, when that word was less controversial in contexts other than somebody using it for racial denigration. In fact, artists like Patti Smith and even John Lennon wrote songs using that word to signify outcasts in society and the disrespected and the downtrodden. And so that is the context in which the song came about. Patti Smith was from the punk generation, and the song referred to how that subculture was shit on by society and by the, quote, respectable music world at large. And Marilyn Manson recycled it in the 90s to refer to the movement he was a figurehead of. The freaks, the goths, the outcasts, the kids with dyed black hair, leather outfits, buckles and studs, etc., etc. So why did we choose to play it? Well, for a few reasons. Partly because Marilyn Manson was one of the biggest names in rock and in the world at that time. Antichrist Superstar was still a huge album, and he had not even released Mechanical Animals yet. And hell, songs like Disposable Teens and Fight Song would come even years after that. Partly because we've always liked things that were counterculture and shocking. You know, we were playing Two Live Crew on the first episode of WNUT, and they'd fought a huge anti-censorship battle against the U.S. government earlier in the 90s. We'd also featured the Michael Jackson song, They Don't Care About Us, a few episodes before this one, which similarly used an ethnic slur to refer to, like, societal mistreatment and dismissal and that sort of thing, launching its own controversy about freedom of speech and its limits. And lastly, because that word was not as loaded back then as it is today. Now, if you called someone that, absolutely. That was not cool, and you could expect to get your ass kicked. But you could discuss that word. You could sing rap lyrics that had that word in them. You could quote something that used it. And it wasn't half as shocking as it is today in the post-Twitter world. So it's very easy to look at the past through the lens of what we know to be acceptable today, but it's a mistake to do that. There are things that you do and say right now that are going to be problematic, controversial, unacceptable 10 and 20 years from now, and someone is going to tell you then that you should have known better now. But all you can go by today is the guidance we have from the conversations we continue to engage in together. And that'll continue to happen, and things will continue to evolve, and you will realize that terms you use today in a non-disparaging way, or analogies that you make, or voices that you do, are disrespectful or hurtful to someone, somewhere, and that you shouldn't say those things. So yeah, this song was the main reason episode 15 has been unavailable to stream all this time, but we decided to talk about and contribute to the conversation rather than withhold the entire thing forever, even though, let's face it, no one would probably miss this one. It's probably in our bottom 10th percentile for creativity and entertainment value. We were ill-prepared. We were phoning it in. You know, we spent a significant part of the second half just audibly exhausted and running out the clock. So before I go, I encourage you to look into the history of the song and even some of the online discussion around it. You can even sound off yourself right here on this page as long as you do so respectfully. All right, back to the show.
Ain't much been going on here in the studios at WNUT. We just kicked back listening to a little Marilyn Manson. And we're discussing computers and stuff. You know, We were talking about Chris's system, and trust me, everything you see at Chris's house and the system ain't really all that's there. Like, there's more to it than meets the eye. For instance, you put in this one disc, and you click on some of the pictures he's got, and, well, you might see some surprising things. And if we can get Chris on the phone a little bit later, we might get him to explain it to you. But Chris has some things I think even I'm too young to see. Have you seen some of these pictures, Eric?
He never showed them to me.
Well,
I need to get him to send me some.
Chris has some things involving horses and chickens, and
our overseas correspondent Matthew Morgan wanted us to report on something that you can go see in Mexico called a donkey show. Now, these things are illegal, but, you know, especially the military people out in Texas, they'll go down to Mexico to see them. What it is this fine Mexican girl gets in a room, and she, like, starts playing with the donkey till it gets hard. And then she lets it fuck her. What kind of shit is that?
This is Mexicans with nothing better to do at all than send themselves straight to hell. That's what they're doing. And
yeah, man. I mean, who the hell thought of that? I mean, what kind of sick mind said, I know what I'll do. I'll get this girl to screw a donkey.
And then we'll invite people to come watch
it. And then we'll make people pay to watch.
And did Matt say he's been to this?
Yeah, Matt said that they all went down there once. Matt said it was quite sick.
Matt has
and
seen this.
And for confirmation, a boy in Aiken named Chris Powers was re-explaining it to us once, me and a friend of mine named Kirk.
Mm-hmm. And Chris was asking me, Chris Powers, he was asking me if the Jazzman would like to make an appearance on a punk album. Now, Chris, I know you're eventually going to be hearing this. Please contact me at the studios here. I'm not going to give my phone number out here, but you can get it from Eric. Find out where I need to be and when, and the Jazzman can definitely make an appearance anywhere you want him to be, because he's the Jazzman, and he can do that shit. Know what I'm saying? He can even make an appearance on a movie if you want him to, you know? Porn would especially be to the Jazzman's liking if you have a porn movie you got in mind to make, or, you know, anything. So just get in contact with me, and if anybody else wants the Jazzman or any of us to come and do something for you, a little something, you know, just give us a call here. And so let's see. I'm going to look at our legendary idea pad and see what we've got coming up next. Oh, yeah, I keep forgetting to mention this, but this is a first, ladies and gentlemen. Yvonne Holman broke her own record for keeping the damn Christmas tape longer than anybody the world has ever seen. I gave it to her to listen to on December 17th, 1997, got it back on January 30th, 1998. This is pretty bad. Pretty damn bad.
I congratulate you.
You have really just broken not only your own record, but the record of anybody. I mean, if you like it that much, copy it or something. Man, we're flattered, but really, the Christmas broadcast was the one broadcast that we had, like, 2 days to let everybody hear, and we really needed it. So, thank you very much. And, let's see what else we got here. It's too late to do phone calls. We do some of those. Oh, yeah, the Hall of Fame Assembly. Me and Eric have been meaning to explain this one.
Oh, dear God.
In some way, was this biased? I mean, in any way?
Okay, I give them credit that, yeah, everybody had to vote on it, so it probably was just coincidence. But then you have to wonder.
I mean, the teachers do make the final cut, and we had all of these were either cheerleaders or annual staff. You know, in some way, the popular.
I mean, they were all smart. Yeah. There was not one dumb person there.
And so that discriminates against those of us who are stupid.
Yeah, so all the stupid people out there will never be in the Hall of Fame.
Imagine 10 people picked, actually nominated by the senior class and picked, you know, at the final cut by the teachers of North Augusta High School. 10 people, it's all women, all right, except for one person. And that was what, Patrick Zier?
Patrick Zier.
Okay.
And
His mom is a teacher at Paul Knox.
One guy got up there.
One guy. And this is one of those, you know, real popular, everybody, like, you know, it's one of those guys. And the rest are just cheerleaders and secretaries of student offices and all this crap. So, You know, I mean, I didn't really think that I had a chance to get this or anything, but really, I thought maybe somebody did, you know, maybe some other guy.
If you want to know how you can improve your chances to get in the Hall of Fame, read the WNUT newsletter. I wrote an article about it.
Yes, it was in the February 1998 issue, and you can pick that up anywhere that, you know, you see a kid walking around with our damn newsletter, because we've already handed out all we got. Or,
Or you can just email one of us, and we'll send you it over email.
Mm-hmm, because we're going online with our newsletters, and as soon as we finish this broadcast, I'm jaunting out here with Eric, and we're going to work on that stuff till we can't work on it no more.
Guess what editor number two found today?
What did editor number two find?
The first disc of all the newsletters.
Oh, that's good. Well, I a couple of them were, you know, shall we say, messed up. But since we've been so far behind on getting our newsletter out, all you fans can be absolutely sure and positive that we are going to release the March issue with the April issue, okay? We're putting them both out at the same time, so don't worry. You're going to get a March issue. It'll just be late. We're not liars when we say we're never going to miss another month. We mean we're never going to miss another month. So, now that you're caught up with that, let's see what else we got for ya. I think it's time for a Mullis Mix. If you've ever been to a baseball game, say maybe the Braves or here local in Augusta, the Green Jackets, you've heard this. They play this at baseball games for some reason. I don't know. I mean, it just gets the crowds going because it's about a decade-old baseball tune that it's all right for what it is. But here is the remix of Centerfield by John Fogerty, now retitled Homosexual. You'll understand when you hear it. Here goes.
Homosexual. Homosexual.
Thank you very much. One of my many later accomplishments that will be on Mullis Mixes 12, the last Mullis Mixes album ever. Me and Eric are just sitting in the studio once again listening to Marilyn Manson. Does anyone recognize this tune? I mean, it sounds familiar to me. I just can't remember the name of it or anything. So if anybody does, please give me a call. Eric just lost his sack.
But actually, I threw my sack into the fan by accident, and it didn't hit any of the blades. It was a miracle.
Whoa, cool. We've just been sitting here playing with our balls again. You may remember WNUT 97 Part 3, where we did our salute to balls. Well, we've got all those same balls here in the studio now, and plus many several new ones, so we just, you know, been playing with our balls again. Eric's been putting silly putty all over his, and I'm just handling mine. I got this Jimi Hendrix Band of Gypsies album, and if we listen to it before we finish WNUT, we might play a song from it if we... There's a pin. We might play a song from it for you if we really, really, really like it and all, so... Which I'm pretty sure I will. See, it's that one of those remastered Hendrix albums. Let me tell you how remastered I like my music. I like stuff remastered so good, you can hear the cars going by outside on the street. I like hearing the music remastered so good.
I like to be able to hear the lead singer breathe.
Yeah, you can hear people burping down the street. You know what I'm saying? So that's what I'm going to do with all my Mullis mixes as soon as I get around to it. I'm just going to put like a greatest hits album of all of them. Because I got like a greatest hits album of like the first few. And y'all can look forward to it. I'm going to completely remaster all the best ones. Oh, yeah. Eric, did I tell you about when I was helping Miss Belger spell the word scratch in her class? She was writing, okay.
No, I don't think you did.
When Miss Belger is working a problem on the board, this is what she does. She goes over to the side, and you know the way, like, when she's working something, she says, this is our scratch work. I'm going to show you what I'm doing here so you don't get confused. Okay, well, she was doing this. She's, like, you know, making sure that we don't, like, get lost in what she's explaining. So she went over to the side of what she was doing, and she wrote scratch work or whatever. And it was like S-C-R-A-T-H, and she was like, that doesn't look right. So then she put S-C-R-A-C-H, and I was like, that's still not right. She goes, how do you spell scratch? She tried like over and over, and me and Chris were sitting there like, the end of it is T-C-H. She was like, she put something else up there, and it wasn't even right. And I said, listen, you got to put, all right, scratch, like you had it, T-C-H. She, you know, 100 times, still can't get this. So then I just finally said, you know, as in B-I-T-C, and kind of let it fade out. Miss Belger went ballistic. The pen just stops moving. She turns around and she's like, that was stupid. I let a lot of things in this classroom go, but that one was really stupid. I'm considering kicking you out of class. She didn't even know who it was. She was looking around the room while she said this, trying to make it look like she knew who said it. But the reason that no one got kicked out is because she didn't know. And then Travis Morgan behind me starts laughing because that was the funniest thing. And the whole class is cracking up. She's like, that wasn't even funny. It was stupid. And then Travis Morgan busts out laughing behind me. She goes, in fact, I'm still considering kicking you out. I might do it even yet. And so Mike Williams was supposed to go to her like later that week and say, so, Miss Belger, I heard someone helped you spell the word scratch. But it turns out he never did. And I was thinking about saying something in the newsletter about Miss Belger getting all mad at you if you help her spell words, but since she is
I don't think that'd be a very good idea.
Yeah, since she is a regular reader of the newsletter, that in some form or another, that would be my ass. Okay.
No. I think she's not a regular listener.
Let's see what else we got up in here. We can have guests if we call some guests and have them come on here, which only makes sense. We can't have our enforcer on here because he's in jail tonight. Not literally, but his mom is home. And seeing as how she wouldn't even let him go out to come to our pop concert, that's kind of bad. This is something I'm going to tackle in the newsletter and write about it, probably in the April issue. But, Eric, what do you think about this crap in the morning where they lock the gym doors and don't let us in? What kind of bullshit is this?
Well, it doesn't affect us too much anymore because we found about every conceivable way of breaking in anyway.
And then they forget for the rest of the day to unlock... like, all four of the doors that help you get out.
Okay, I hope they have a fire in the gym one day and they get, like, really yelled at by the fire department for chaining up all but one of the doors out of the building.
They got three sets of double doors, folks. This equals six doors lined up that people can go out of the gym, and we've never had a problem with people getting out of there. It's been traffic flow, like, cool and just smooth, you know, everybody gets out, get to your class. But now they keep four of those doors locked now with a big fat chain, and you can't exactly open them, all right, because Terlizzi wants to be a turd. So he opens one set of doors, and the entire gym full of people, this gym can hold probably about 4,000 people. They just, when the bell rings, everybody has to leave through those two doors right there, and that's bull.
You know what? Mr. Shalizzi recently woke up one morning and said, I'm going to be an asshole. The Junior Miss pageant, whether you care about that or not, had to be held at Paul Knox because he woke up that morning and he said, no, we can't have it in the auditorium or the gym. You know, he just kind of felt that way.
Did he give a reason?
No, just he didn't want it. They had to have an administrator give permission. And, well, they got at Paul Knox because that person said, you know, I don't know who's the principal there. I was thinking it's Miss Twiggs, but I guess she quit.
Maybe it's Mr. Head.
Yeah, maybe.
Mr. Dick Head.
But anyway.
You may remember us talking about him in our 1994 broadcasts, if you were a fan back then.
Another thing that we can't have in, another thing that we can't have moved is that the very last week of school when most of the seniors aren't going to be there, and, you know, this doesn't affect me, but I heard some people talking about because they wanted to come to it, was the, I don't know, what they do at the end of the year? It's not the Hall of Fame, but it's like the Honor Day or
is
something
it
like that.
The Baccalaureate or whatever?
I don't know, but they do it at the end of the year, but this year, I guess they don't care if the seniors come or not because they are holding it when we don't have to come to school that last week. Mm-hmm. And, well, they asked Mr. Trelizzi if they could have it changed, and he basically said, no. He doesn't want to hold up school.
All due to the fact that he woke up one morning and said, I'm going to be an ass.
Yeah.
That's what he said. I'm going to be an ass.
Maybe for the senior prank, maybe we should change it to getting some big old wire cutters, just cutting all the locks.
Actually, I thought about, if they want the doors chained up that bad, why don't we just go buy some chain, some master locks, chain up every entrance to the school. You know, they don't have the key to it. If they want the doors chained up that damn bad, we can do it for them. Okay? I don't have an objection when I know that they're the ones getting screwed. I'm tired of being screwed. Never thought I'd hear myself say that, but I'm tired of being screwed. So it's time to screw back. Now, in commemoration of how exactly 4 years ago, like next week, it will mark the anniversary of when Kurt Cobain was found dead in his Seattle home, the garage above his house, and it was really a shocking thing for the entire nation because we all love Nirvana, except for, you know, a few of us, not to name any names, Yvonne, but we all, you know, seem to like Nirvana, and that just kind of rocked.
We all have a special place in our heart for them.
Yeah, yeah, exactly, because this alternative thing, just as soon as Kurt was gone, there it went. You know, that was kind of the end of the whole alternative flame. It lost its charm real quick right after that. And it was going strong and stuff, and everybody knew that except Kurt, so he killed himself. And we decided that since April 8th, 1998, will mark the four-year anniversary. It's kind of a jovial word to use for such a bad thing, but it'll mark the anniversary of Kurt Cobain's death. We decided to dedicate a special segment of our program to Kurt Cobain tonight, since we didn't get to do this 4 years ago when we made WNUT. We're going to do it right now, and I've got a song right now that I'd like to dedicate to Kurt. This is the Bloodhound Gang with Lift Your Head Up High and Blow Your Brains Out. Kurt, that one is dedicated to your immortal spirit. That one's dedicated to you, Kurt, wherever you may be.
The goddamn bed is blue!
Goddammit.
While we're in the mood to dedicate things to people, I would now like to take this opportunity to dedicate a small segment to all the people who felt compelled by the Lord to jump in and help me and Eric last week with our dilemma. This is to all of you. Thanks for your help.
Enjoy.
Fuck you! Yeah, kiss my ass, motherfucker. Fuck you. God damn it. Yeah, yeah, your mama too.
Amen. You helped us absolutely none. You didn't phase us. Try again.
Fuck you! Fuck you! Fuck you! Fuck you!
That's to all of you.
We know where y'all come from. We still love all y'all.
Yeah, we got no hate for y'all. Let's see. Now we got more stuff to do. Moving on from that. By the way, does anyone know exactly what that was that the Bloodhound Gang was saying backwards in that song we played? It sounded a little bit like... When you actually flip that back around and you play it the real way, that actually says, "The devil shall awake and eat Chef Boyardee beefaroni." It says that over and over.
Devil shall wake up and eat Chef Boyardee beefaroni. Devil shall wake up and eat Chef Boyardee beefaroni. Devil shall wake up and eat Chef Boyardee beefaroni.
Isn't that amazing?
It is.
It's pretty damn good. We're still looking for stuff to do, by the way, folks. And let's see. Oh, me and John Pardue are working on this because his voice sounds exactly like the guy on the Motel 6 ad. We're going to make this false Motel 6 ad. And it's going to be real funny because I'm even going to make like the cheesy background stuff. We're going to send it to some radio stations and all. So hopefully we'll get something with that. And, it'll be funny. You'll remain updated from us because we're going to, you know, keep you updated on that. So right now, hold on a second. We got the door here. Take the microphone, Eric.
Hey, guys. Well, oh, my God.
What's up? Hey, okay, how's it going?
Hey, Jazzman, what's up?
How's it going? You like WJAZ Part 2?
Yeah, I liked it pretty good.
Did Kirk and Chris ever hear that other one?
They never heard Part 2, but, I don't know. I don't know, we have to ask them.
All I gotta say is, damn y'all, square to hell.
I don't know, did you ever give one to Kirk and Chris and Aiken?
I gave one to you, bitch.
Yeah, no, I never gave it to him, so I guess not. When you gonna let me hear Part 3?
Right now, motherfucker, look what I got with me.
Hey, look at that.
I got Part 3 for you.
Motherfucker. Okay, the Jazzman presents you with Part 3. Wait a second. Before he gives this tape to him, there's something on there that we need to play. This is, well, you introduce it, Jazzman.
Straight from Augusta, Georgia. Here's the godfather of soul, James Brown.
Blues Brother 2000. See ya.
Yeah, motherfucker. Plain and simple. Blues Brothers 2000. See it. See that shit. See it for your motherfucking self. Have you ever seen Blues Brothers 2000?
I've never seen Blues Brothers 2000.
Have you seen the first one?
Yeah, on Comedy Central.
That shit's funny as hell, boy.
That shit was pretty funny.
That shit's funny, man. But, yeah, on WJAZ Part 3, we talk about Blues Brothers a whole lot. Because it's like a celebration. And it's pretty good, man.
So, Jazzman, how's it been going?
It's been good, man. I've been getting laid by that bitch, Esther. Man, I've been getting some pussy every night.
Well, ain't nothing wrong with that, you know what I'm saying? It's just some good old-fashioned relations, and as I've said before, it ain't nothing wrong with relations. Got any questions for the Jazzman, Eric?
So Jazzman, do you ever, fart when you relate?
No, man, see, it happened to me one time, way back when, but see, that shit was so embarrassing, that girl never talked to me again. And man, she was a fine motherfucker, too, so I felt bad about it, you know, because I ain't never getting no more of that puss. And if there was one piece of puss I could get again, it'd be that one. But man, she got away from me because I blew it. Literally.
Does Commander Weber ever, fart when y'all, Oh, wait, you don't swing that way.
I should, kick your ass real quick. But, I'll let that one slide, seeing as how, you know, y'all the editors and all.
Yeah, I hear you.
It's like, you know, that wouldn't be a very good move, Jazzman. So, the way I hear, the enforcers are gearing up for another mission, and we don't exactly know who this will be or what it's going to be, but you plan on rolling with them, Jazzman?
Yeah, man, me and the enforcers can put down some ass whoop when the time really comes, and I've been looking forward to it, too, because them enforcers, man, they some crazy motherfuckers, especially that six-pack. Man, he's disturbed. He got some mental problems, I think.
Well, what do you think about the enforcers, Eric? Do you think they have mental problems?
No, they're just doing their job.
Yeah, that's true. It's like, if you look at it that way, we all got mental problems here at WNUT. And, you think of any more questions for the Jazzman, Eric?
So Jazzman, are you thinking of making part 4?
Yeah, man, it'll happen a little bit later, because I'm getting behind with these motherfuckers. Actually, I'm getting ahead of myself. I'll make one of these goddamn things, and then nobody will hear it right. And, I'll be done made the next one, and people still gotta hear the old one. For instance, I got part 3 already done, but everybody ain't heard part 2 yet. So it'll probably be sometime maybe over the summer, you know what I'm saying? Or maybe right before school lets out.
Yeah, there you go. Who else has got here too? Are you alright, Jazzman? You're making me cough too.
I got some problems.
Yeah, maybe you should take a break from making so many albums.
Yeah, damn it.
You might permanently damage your vocal cords like Miss Patterson's gonna do.
This voice is all fucked up. I don't know if y'all can tell. I don't really sound like the average motherfucker.
It'll be alright. Well, anyway.
I better go. See y'all later.
So, Brandon, what do you think about Jazzman?
Well,
doing all right?
I don't blame him there. I know how he feels. I've been sick for the past week or so, and I'm just finally getting over that now. So, all I can say is, Jazzman, I wish you the best of luck, and hopefully you'll get over that, because, man, being sick ain't no fun. It's a big, big bitch, and I don't like it. So, although, you know, it's kind of worth it when you hear all them WJAZs. They are funny as hell, and, you know, pretty good. I guess it's kind of worth it, you know. It ain't really that big a waste. But, you know, if we put the Jazzman out of commission and he uses up all his voice and can't talk no more, then, you know, that's kind of the charm of the whole thing, his voice, because he's a crazy laid-back swinging cat and all. So I was going to play something. Oh, by the way, take this to them. The Jazzman has left part 3 with us for Eric to get to whenever he hears part 2, and that doesn't seem to be happening too damn quick, so I don't know. I guess it'll just take it as it comes.
I'll get part 2 to Kirk ASAP.
Let's see. We got the last Mother's Mixes album here. I'm going to play some stuff. You know the way that Butterfly Kisses song came out, and all of a sudden it was like the big thing, the big old hit, and everybody's got to hear Butterfly Kisses. Every acoustic outdoor show you go to, they're playing Butterfly Kisses. Well, I got sick of it, so I did this. Trust me, ladies and gentlemen, it's a big improvement. I made the song actually cool to listen to. I got more balls than the Daily Lottery. Here's Butterfly Pisses.
Mm-hmm. Twist.
Thank you. That was Butterfly Pistons. I hope you all enjoyed that. What do you think of that, Eric?
That just went together so well.
Did y'all notice that? Go back and listen to that again. The verses and all are like the same length. It was timed perfectly because, like, I don't know. I guess maybe the way the Wizard of Oz and Pink Floyd works, I guess that kind of works the same way.
One of those astrological coincidences.
It's one of those things that just, it's the damnedest thing. I tell you what. So let's see. While we're at it, we're going to look in our famous notepad again. Here we go. That's right. I've been planning on doing this for a long time. So I'm going to bring out the special guest that I've been planning to have on here since he was last on here, and we talked him into doing something a little dangerous, and he did it, and here he is, the Urinator.
Hello, I am back. You remember what happened last time I was on here?
You lost your... yeah.
Coincidentally, you were doing the salute to balls even then.
Yeah, and, well, we saluted you losing your nuts.
It was not very fun. I lost my balls. But I did get some replacements.
Really? Are they bigger and better than the old one?
Well, they're big. I can't come, and it's hard to have sex, but you know, it's pretty good.
Are they like 15-pound balls?
No. My sack's not that strong.
Oh, okay. I'm sorry.
But it kind of messed up my voice, because you heard me talking like, for a while, and but I just want to tell you, I don't appreciate it. You talked me into doing that, and...
Well, it smells real nice in here, Urinator, thank you. And you gotta be a pretty dumb person to do that anyway. If we tell you to slice off your nads, it's like, Eric, here's some scissors, go slice off your balls. What is your reaction to this?
No, Brandon, why don't you go slice your own nuts off?
But the Urinator, no. His reaction is, okay, I'll go do it. So, you have only yourself to blame for that, Urinator. Oh, by the way, you know, I always tell you people about back in 1994 when we did WNUT for a little while, and we signed off after our Christmas special, so we weren't heard from for about, you know, 3 years there, and we started back last year, but between the sign-off and last year's return, we did one thing that was never released. It wasn't even Eric, it was me and Kirk. Kirk was over here one day, and it was the interview with the Urinator, and it's... just not quite like anything you've heard before. So here is segments, it's not the entire thing, but segments from the never-before-released interview with the Urinator, which happened over the course of sometime in 1995. We will eventually release the whole thing when we do our final episode.
No.
Oh, that was good.
No.
Eric just tossed a ball completely over the stack of equipment, and it's behind with all the wires. Oh, well. But here are segments from... the actual interview with the Urinator. Here goes.
And here he is, ladies and gentlemen. Hello, Urinator.
Hi.
Good to have you back in the studio, and I hope this time you reveal a little more than you did last time. It's good to see you, man.
So good to see you again.
Yeah, that's what I just said. We're going to be taking calls. People got questions for the Urinator, call us right here. Our phone number is 666-0911. Don't ask. You know, I was just thinking you were in that bathroom for a long time. Did you do anything besides whiz?
Blow me.
Okay, I won't ask you anything like that again. We're going to take some calls now. The switchboards are lighting up. We'll go to caller one. Hello, caller one. You're on the air live with the Urinator. What's your question?
Hi.
Hi.
When was the last time you had a good piss?
He was in the bathroom right before we came on the air with him, lady.
Make it a part of your everyday life.
You know, that's good because I really wouldn't feel too good if I didn't do that every day. Okay, right now I've got a question for you, Urinator. We saw you walking around the other day in the mall parking lot. Me and my homie here were leaving and we were rolling by. We saw you walking by. You must have been shopping, man, since you're visiting down here. Anything in particular you're shopping for?
Pussy.
Well, Augusta, Georgia is the right place to look for something like that. We're going to go to caller 2 right now. Yes, caller 2, you're live on the air with the Urinator. What's your question? And do you even have one?
Yeah. Where's the little shit?
No, you're not talking about Arnold, are you? Did you hear what he said that Urinator?
Blow me.
That's the way to take care of people like that. Now, see, Arnold, what are your views on things like the Oklahoma City bombing?
Come on, you see, this is the problem with terrorists. They're really inconsiderate when it comes to people's schedules.
And what do you think about WNUT team of Brandon and Kirk here? What do you think about that, man?
What a team!
Why, thank you!
Thank you!
You heard that, didn't you, Kirk?
That was beautiful.
Rapping with Arnold.
I'll be back.
That was, of course, from the Urinator's 1988 hit movie Twins. And we've got Arnold in
the
festive
mood
here. He's kind of sick.
Oh, you don't get no spending cash.
Shut up!
If you don't scrap that kitchen floor...
Arnold, the song's over. Arnold.
You ain't gonna rock and roll no more.
Sit down.
Yuck. Don't talk back.
Sit down.
Do you know that there's something that you can do that will make a fantastic difference in your life?
Urinator, we ain't gonna talk about that kind of stuff here right now.
Unfortunately, I have to leave. I have a plane to catch.
Aw, don't leave.
Dickhead.
Hey, I was sorry I didn't cut the connection with that last caller. Okay, there we go. I took care of it. Arnold, if you got anything else to say, you know, as a goodbye type thing, just go ahead and say what you got to say real quick, man.
Yakety yak. I'll be back.
We have now officially relocated to the house of editor number 2. We're at Eric's house now. We've been working on the webpage and stuff, and now we're just down in his room / the basement, just relaxing and stuff.
Magical third studio.
Yeah. We have several different places from which we can broadcast. He had a lengthy conversation with Brandy, and I sat there and cut and pasted stuff to put newsletters on the webpage. So we're doing all this for you fans, and you better visit our webpage once we get finally in full swing. So, because if you don't, we're going to put foots in your ass. Asses. That's plural. There are more than one of you.
Yeah, hopefully there are many of you.
Yeah. So, you feeling a little tired there, Eric, or can you go on?
I can go on.
We only got about 30 minutes left in the tape.
Oh,
by the way, ladies and gentlemen, I want to tell you about something which happened to me yesterday when I was pulling out of the parking lot of school. You know that little prep girl, Nicole Clary, you know?
Yeah.
All right. Well, it's like, if you ever see her in her car, please, whatever you do, don't pull out in front of her, because I was trying to leave, and she was way, way back, so I pulled out, and then her car, she, like, bum-rushes me with her car, and all of a sudden, like, in the space of about half a second, her car's, like, right up on mine, but I'm already pulled out and, like, ready to leave the parking lot, so what can I do? I can't let her go by me. And then, Daniel Burkhalter was in the car with me, and then just from behind us, we hear this barrage of, "You fucker!" just comes straight at us from nowhere for no reason. So if you see that girl, steer completely clear of her when she's in her car, because there's no telling what she'll say to you, you know, if you take the royal right of way from her. So.
Yeah, I don't know. What's up with that?
People are nice these days.
Except for those people.
Yeah.
Those are the kind of people that get pegged by the enforcers. You know, she might just find a interstate barricade in her front yard because, well, there's plenty of those around because they're messing with I-20 all the time.
I'd say so. We can find all kind of stuff to do to people. Let's see what all we got on here. Think about this spooky poo-poo, ladies and gentlemen. This year is 1998, and we have 3 Friday the 13th this year. 1998 divided by 3 is 666. Isn't that odd? That's a little odd. That's scary as piss. Also, do this. Take each letter in Marilyn Manson's name and figure out what number
of the alphabet.
What number, you know, each letter of the alphabet would be, like on a scale of 1 to 26. Add them all up and see if it comes out to 666. We would do it, but we're too damn tired.
It just kind of sounds like something he'd do on purpose.
Yeah, because he does weird stuff like that on purpose, and he's odd like that, because he's damn Marilyn Manson, for one thing.
The man who wants to steal your children and shit.
And become an idol and, yeah.
And be the Antichrist.
Yeah.
Although, you know, if he wanted to be the Antichrist, he can't come out and say he's the Antichrist. Because the Antichrist, well, for one thing, he's scary as hell. And the Antichrist is supposed to be somebody who's, like, real lovable and charismatic, and that he sure ain't.
Yeah, like Napoleon and Hitler.
And it's just... It's just so odd because, you know, he's, like, wanting to be Antichrist, but he's, like, making himself everything that it's the opposite of. That's just weird, you know? I thought about that.
These are deep thoughts we're having at Punch Drunk 11:10 at night.
Yeah, because, see, normally we don't relocate ourselves to a completely different studio in the middle of recording and things, so, you know. Oh, we had a fun episode at Crystal today. We went over to get something to eat after the chorus concert, you know? And so, like... We went to McDonald's, but a bunch of us walked over to Crystal, and we walked in, and, like, Mandy Schmidt and them had got their food, and they were sitting down at the table by the window, and they, like, looked up, and there were all these bugs on the wall, and, I mean, they were those little termite ant-looking things
yeah.
all over the damn wall in Crystal, and nobody that worked there knew that the bugs were there. So we walked over to the window, and we were like, hey, man, y'all got a bunch of bugs in this motherfucker, and I was, like, yelling behind the counter, and said, hey, y'all got more bugs in this motherfucker than I've seen, and they were, like, looking at us, like, what, and I said, there's bugs over here by the window, and Manny and them got up and, like, acted disgusted, and they all left, you know, so we came back, and there was this old guy sitting down, like, eating and stuff, and she pointed out the bugs or something, like, in some way to him, and he got up and left. He was like, that's nasty shit, and he got up and left. And then some kids from the course ran over there, and they were like, hey, there go the boarding man outside. The damn boarding man was in the drive-thru getting a burger. So we all ran out to his truck, and we were like, hey, they got bugs in this restaurant. And then the woman giving him the food in the window, she heard us, and she had, like, known the commotion we were making in there before. And we were like, hey, man, they got bugs in this motherfucker. You need to get out and get... And he, like, rolled his window down. He was like, yo, man, tell me what's going on. I was like, they got bugs all up on the window in there and stuff. And he was like, he pulled around, he acted like he was going to go in, you know. By that time, Joseph had walked in there, and they were like, why do they keep wanting to talk to the board man? And Joseph pointed over to the window. And the guy that worked behind the counter saw the bugs, and he was like, oh, shit. So they went over there and tried to kill him or whatever. It was kind of funny, because we found the boarding man on him. How priceless can that be? It was, like, timed perfect.
Yeah.
That just worked so well.
At Winn-Dixie, if the board man finds lots of bugs at our store, he could, like, write us up and make us pay money.
That's what they should have done to Crystal. Man, it was nasty. I'm talking, like, these things could have covered... Ashley Allen's entire body. She was there with us. I mean, these things could have, like, jumped on her and just covered her completely. You wouldn't even seen her. That was how many there were, just on the window. They tried to get me to pull the blinds up so the bugs would get pissed and just fly all around the store, but I was like, no, I'm not going to do that. Because that would be kind of bad, you know. All the things attacking people. And this one old lady, man. We tried to get this old lady that was eating to, like, bite into the sandwich and go, ah, something just crunched, but she wouldn't do it. And then John Pardew walked up to the thing, and he goes, I want a number one upsize minus the bugs and a can of Raid. I want to order a French fries. It was funny. We had quite a good time. It was fun. Here's our semi-weird song for this broadcast, WNUT 98's LSD, also known as Life, Sex, and Death, with Fucking Shit Ass. This song is dedicated to all of those aforementioned people who tried to help me and Eric last week with our problem. We mean help in the least possible way you could mean help. Thank you. Yeah.
I would like to at this time remind those same people of this message.
Fuck you!
That one's important.
I got a really cool Jimi Hendrix record today, everybody. It was the Band of Gypsies, the live thing that he did, you know, the thing, whatever it was, on New Year's Eve, you know, and it was one of them expensive bastards that cost me a left nut. Because it's remastered and it's on real fucking thick vinyl. Ooh! Eric just grabbed up a copy of Elton John's Goodbye Yellow Brick Road on vinyl. That's good.
The record is gone.
I like that.
The record is gone. Oh, there it is.
The God. Oh, there it is. The record's there.
I wanted to see how this one was scratched.
Well, it has two records in that set.
Girl, this one's not really that bad.
Oh, that's good. That record looked good. I want that record. Motherfucker.
I thought maybe I still had it in there.
I bet it's probably up on your turntable.
No,
wait a minute.
That Aerosmith record's up on my turntable.
Wait a minute, where's the turntable at?
It's inside there.
Oh. We, for a moment, lost Eric's turntable. That's pretty damn sad. We're just telling you these things because it's real late at night and we don't have other stuff to say. Because if we did, we'd say that stuff, but we don't.
Oh, God, yeah.
We don't have that stuff right now, so we're just saying any other stuff. He's got an old Nintendo hooked up, and I don't have one of those anymore because I gave it to Shanna. I know anything you put in Shanna's room is going to get fucked up. It's like a destiny.
Yeah, I needed this Nintendo because I had to still play old Final Fantasy, Legend of Zelda, and baseball.
Hey, you ever see that advertisement from Meineke with George Foreman like doing the stuff? He's like, over the years, I've been hit just about everywhere. You know, you ever see that thing? All right, well, I remixed it for the Mellis Mixes 11 album, and listen to this. Here's George Foreman with an advertisement for Meineke. Sure.
Over the years, I've been hit just about everywhere. And I gotta tell you, I don't like it. But there's one place I especially don't like getting hit. That's the
scrotum.
I guarantee it.
On this point, I will have to agree with the man. I don't like getting hit in the scrotum either. But there's one thing that's not all that bad, and it's this.
Over the years, I've been just about everywhere. And I gotta tell you, I like it. But there's one place I especially like getting hit. That's the
dick.
I guarantee it.
There ain't nothing all that damn bad about that. That's kind of good.
George, he's kind of like Mr. Rushton. It's like they both went to college wanting to be preachers. It's just one of them became a teacher and the other one became a boxer.
And they both discussed their sex lives.
Yeah.
At random. And like two people who don't really give a fuck. But you know, for Mr. Rushton, it's good because it gets us out of doing stuff.
Yeah, man.
I don't mind that. I'll explain my sex life to him. Okay, sir, I don't get any. There's my whole sex life. Everybody remember that song by Collective Soul called Shine? Well, here's a little preview from Mellis Mixes 12. Pretty cool, huh? Here's some more.
Mother,
fuck off.
Tell your children not to
suck my dick.
Tell your children not to hear my what they mean, what they say. Mother,
fucker.
All your mental
nuts
drags me down. Nothing
sucks my dick
like your mouth.
I'll be goddamned. Let me give you all a fair warning about something real quick. Our enforcer number one, Hollywood, he tried to get me to watch this porno tape one time.
He tried to get you to watch it? You mean he had to force you to watch the porno?
he tricked me.
Okay.
Let me tell you what's up. Let me tell you what's going on, see? I thought I was going to see some good tits and ass. I don't have an objection to some good tits and ass. So upon sitting down to watch this porno tape with Chris, he pops the thing in, and guess what's going on? The first scene in the whole porno movie was this guy and this other guy just doing each other in the asshole. And this is not a damn joke. He really put me through this horror. And I don't appreciate it very much.
If you're going to tell me that I'm going to see some good porn, at least make it be with a chick in it. Thank you. That's my only simple request. Let this be a fair warning to you, Eric.
Don't worry. I'll never watch porn at Chris's house. You don't got to worry about that. Oh, since we forgot our disclaimer, I'll just go ahead and throw out disclaimer warnings to everybody at the end here, and how we apologize to everybody offended. Oh, yeah.
And plus, I guess you thought this whole hour and a half that you were going to get to nail us, but we remembered the disclaimer at the very end.
Yeah, so, sorry, guys. We almost forgot it.
Actually, no, we're not sorry.
Or, yeah, something like that. It's like...
We don't give a fuck.
Yeah, Chris, don't come, like, barricade my house. Brandon said it. And
we got a disclaimer, too, bunghole.
And, everybody else out there, just general sorriness. Yeah.
On all of you. Bastards.
Yeah, take that like you will. Take that as you will. Take it for its worth. But most of all, take it.
Yeah, take it and don't say a motherfucking thing.
Fourth, there's one thing I know, is I know not everything, but just something.
And for all you guys out there, try walking down the hall and just saying this to any girl at random.
That's because you have big
tits!
Listen to this junk. He says, are you new in the building? And she says, yes, I just moved in. And then he says, that's because you have big tits. That's why she moved in early. I mean, that's why she moved in. See, listen.
New in the building?
Yeah, I just moved in Monday.
Oh, that's because you have big...
It's like a hotel for the largely boobed.
She moved in for the heavingly inclined.
For the well-endowed. It's because you have big boobs that you
for
moved...
the Madonna or...
But what is he doing Dolly living
Parton
there?
Dolly Parton look-alike.
Plus, there's this one.
Everybody's been real nice.
Well, that's because you have big
balls!
I want to squeeze them!
I can tell you from experience it's no good idea to squeeze balls. But unfortunately, me and Eric have to go here, so we're going to sign off now, and this is what the hell is today. Thursday, the 26th of March, and in about probably 2 seconds, it'll be Friday.
Yeah, and for the meantime, we're just going to... fill the tape full of crap like we always do.
And we're going to make more newsletters, so don't worry. This is Eric and Brandon saying goodbye.
Hola. Oh, yeah, this was the Masters edition. We didn't say much about the Masters, but, yeah, it was dedicated to other people's balls.
And the Masters is on the way, trust us. So we'll just leave you with some more crap from Mullis Mixes. Bye-bye.
It's the man that you love to hate. Coming out of Washington State. Cops don't like my profile. Cause Mix a lot. Much style, so the man is on my trail. He wanna take Mix to tell. If he does, I make the bail. Cause I know a lot of rich females. I'm shaking them just like this. Keeping that
dick just piss.
King County, cops don't quit. Even when a young brother's legit. So they follow me wherever I go. I am on the road.